This is the Money Hour with your host, Tina Mitchell, on Alternative Talk, AM 1150. Now, back to the show with local mortgage and finance expert, Tina Mitchell.
Welcome back to the Money Hour with your host and mortgage expert, Tina Mitchell, right here on 1150 AM KKNW, the Saturday, October 24th show. I'm empowering our community, providing you with opportunities and solutions when it comes to your money. If you're hearing my show at a different time or day, you are listening to a rebroadcast. You can call the show at 1-855-400-1150. Again, 1-855-400-1150, or go online to themoneyhour.com. First time in studio, excited to talk with you today, Kurt. I have Kurt Nystrand with Keller Williams Realty Bellevue. As a buyer in today's real estate market, it's pretty crazy out there with the lack of inventory. Being prepared on exactly how to navigate through the process is important if you want to win in today's market. So, Kurt, thank you again for coming into studio.
Oh, thanks for having me, Tina.
And a little background on Kurt. Kurt has served in the real estate industry since 2005 and with Keller Williams Realty since early 2009 and represents both buyers and sellers with their continuous goal of meeting and exceeding his clients' expectations. Kurt has experienced negotiating contracts and representing clients so that their best interest is served. He has earned the Certified Negotiation Expert, Accredited Buyer Representative, Certified Real Estate Analyst, and Certified Short Sale Negotiator designation to represent and negotiate the buyers and sellers. Customer satisfaction, Kurt's number one priority, and is his honor to represent his clients with honesty and integrity throughout the real estate experience. His goal is to listen to each person he works with in effort to learn more about their unique situation and help them through the next step. Additionally, Kurt is an official trainer for the Washington State Housing Finance Commission and co-teach home buyer education classes with lenders for people interested in learning more about what they should know before buying a home. One thing I talked in Money Chat is the mortgage credit certificate, grant programs that are available, which you need to go to these certified classes and lenders and realtors teach. So, Kurt, thank you for giving back there to our community. So let's go ahead and start talking about multiple offer scenario, because I think everybody in, at least in the popular areas in our market, are in multiple offers. So with preparing your clients for multiple offers, what are you doing, Kurt?
Well, really, ideally, preparation is the key on that. And I always recommend that the buyer sits down with their agent and has a buyer's consultation with them. And a lot of things happen there. You get to know your agent better, your agent gets to know you better and what your needs are. And then I like to go over general things that will be taking place throughout the process to try to eliminate as many surprises as possible. Things like how much earnest money should they offer, or how much does an inspection cost, and give them an opportunity to review contracts ahead of time and things along those lines.
All important to make sure that they're completely prepared to win in a multiple offer scenario. So, Kurt, as a real estate agent, how important is it for their agent to actually pick up the phone and have a conversation with the listing agent prior to presenting that offer?
I think it's huge. I think it can be the difference in some cases on whether you get chosen or not. Basically, what the goal is when you're calling the other agent is to try to find out what's important to the seller. Mm-hmm. And price obviously is often the first thing that's mentioned, but price isn't always the thing that makes a difference between an offer being chosen or not. For example, in some cases, sometimes the assumption is that short closing, the quicker you can close, the better your chance of getting the home. Well, if that seller is looking to purchase their own home, a 2-week close might scare the willies out of
them. Yes.
Yeah, and so they might prefer a 45 or even a 60-day close. And so if that's an option for your buyer, then knowing that, again, can make a huge difference. In some cases too, especially if they are looking at buying their next home, sometimes being able to stay in the home after closing for a couple days for that transition could be very helpful also. And so as many of those things that you can get straightened out before mm-hmm. you even send your offer over, then the greater chance of them choosing yours.
It's such important advice, and there's so many things that are going on during the real estate process. Having a realtor that's taking the extra time to do the things that are necessary, because just like you said, it can be a complete disaster if you don't prep and understand exactly what that seller needs. So what about a buyer, Kurt? Are you advising your buyers to put together personal letter? I've heard it be called the love letter to the seller. Or what kind of advice do you have on that?
Yeah, you know, in general, I think it can make the difference. Mm-hmm. However, you also have to be very careful in how you're doing it. You can't violate fair housing and go into familial status and stuff like that. However, it can be an opportunity to try to connect with the seller. And recently I was actually in a class and I thought the teacher gave some good advice. He basically said, as you're going through the home, pay attention to what's on the walls, what's in the garage and stuff. Mm-hmm. And for example, maybe they have pictures in the hallway about their trip to Paris, or you go into the garage and they have motorcycles in there, or classic cars or something like that. And one example of that is recently I was helping a couple look for home, and we went into this one home that they wanted to pursue. And we noticed two specific things while we were there. Number one, when you went into the man cave area, so to speak, they had this kind of like a street sign up above the door that said like Seahawks Lane or something like that. So obviously, or apparently, they were Seahawks fans.
Yes.
And then the second thing is, we went into the garage and the seller had a Mustang in the garage. And to be honest with you, it didn't really strike me as any type of a fancy car. It looked dusty, looks like it'd been there forever, barely worked on. But oftentimes when people have Mustangs, they, sometimes they're collectors or something like that. And so in their letter, they brought up a few things. They talked about, hey, we saw your sign about the Seahawks. And he started talking about how he had been a fan for the last 20 years and he went through the bad years. And so he's really enjoying the Super Bowl run. And and then they talked about how they loved how big the garage was. And they summed it up in just a few words and said, oh, and by the way, nice Mustang. And they capitalized Mustang.
Nice.
And and through that, there were multiple offers in this situation, and we were the ones that were chosen, and they ended up closing. And the agent mentioned to me that one of the things that they really enjoyed was the letter that they'd written, because they really related
to it. It makes total sense, because you're connecting with, on an emotional level, with a seller. And when somebody's selling their house, there's a lot of emotions involved in doing that. So being able to connect there. And as Kurt said, just in the advice, it's not writing about you and your family and your children, because that's where you can get into that area that could be a problem. It's making it about the seller and making comments on everything that's important to the actual seller of that home. Awesome advice. What about shortening any terms in the contract? What can you assist with there in our buyers?
Yeah, that again can be another very large piece to the puzzle when there's multiple offers. And one example could be on, if you're using the typical contracts for an offer on the inspection contingency, the default time period is 10 days. And most buyers love that because they've got plenty of time to do the inspection and they can sleep on it for multiple days and so forth. For the seller, though, they're on pins and needles, because if a deal falls apart, they certainly can fall apart after the inspection is done, but the greatest likelihood is something goes wrong with the inspection.
Mm-hmm.
And so what I advise my clients is trying to shorten that period voluntarily when you submit your offer, where it's long enough so that you can get a good inspector out there, but it might take calling a few to see what their schedules are and such. However, not so long again that there's a balance in there. So usually at least between 5 to 7 days is often plenty of time to get somebody out there to get a good inspection and decide what the response will be. If it's a really competitive scenario, gosh, if you can get that down to 2 or 3 days, that would be even more ideal, as long as the buyer also needs enough time to do their due diligence also, of course.
Of course. Yeah. And on the buyer's side, I mean, it's getting more critical right now with TRID and the new timelines that are coming in with the CFPB to really get that taken care of. So good advice there. Now, let's get into the pre-approval process and the importance of that, and also what your lender partner can do in helping with the buyer in a multiple offer arena.
Yeah, with the lending and pre-approvals, one critical piece of that is doing your homework up front with your lender and getting a good local lender who you trust, who can take care of you, and then turning everything in as quickly as you can to them so that they can do their job to get you fully pre-approved. The one thing I've learned especially on the listing side, is not every pre-approval letter is equal to the other.
Yes.
And if the listing agent is, in my opinion, doing their job and representing their client well, then once they receive your offer, whether there's a multiple offer or not, then they should be calling the lender, introducing themselves, saying, hey, great, I got this offer from your client.
Yep.
And tell me where we're at. And they may ask, gosh, did they turn in their tax records? Have they turned in their last two pay stubs and the bank records and so forth? And empowering your, if you can empower your lender to brag about you,
yes,
then that can completely set you apart. Whereas if you're the listing agent's calling them up and the lender's hemming and hawing, or, you know, trying to change the subject or whatever, then obviously, or they just tell them, no, gosh, they haven't turned that in yet, then the likelihood of you being chosen is very small.
Yep. And maybe even a little extra on top of that is, as a lender, you know, pick up the phone, call the listing agent before they call you and let them know, hey, I've just got your offer. Congratulations. My buyer's just submitted an offer. Congratulations. I work with Kurt on this, just to let you know that they're good to go, completely pre-approved. Oh, by the way, to look at my guarantee on my closing on the second page. Okay, that was a shout out for me because I do guarantee my closing.
Nice.
So whatever that you have to offer is making that call before they call you. Now, what about if I've got somebody listening to the show right now that is going, you know what, I'm just going to present a lowball offer, Kurt, and, you know, get some negotiation going on here. How do you deal with that comment?
Yeah, you know, if there's no other offers out there, you might be successful in getting a response still. Although, honestly, even if there's no offers, if you're too low, you might just make them mad and they don't call at all.
Yes.
So there's certainly balance in there. But if you understand that there are multiple offers, realistically, most, I think human nature-wise, we're drawn to the path of least resistance.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you've got, let's say, 5 offers to choose from, one of them is under list, maybe even way under list, and the rest of them are over, then especially usually the seller and their agent picks the one that fits their criteria the most,
yes,
that gives them the most price at the best terms. And there might maybe 90% of it is what they want, and maybe they just want to adjust, you know, 1 or 2 items on there. That's the agent that they're going to be calling. Whereas the other 4 often don't get the phone call until either late that night or the next day saying, sorry, someone else was chosen. So.
Yeah. The worst mistake that you can make is not understand how the process really is working. And you understand what you're really negotiating. Every $1,000, a little bit less than $5 a month in your payment. So do you want to get into a home in this market or not? You've got to really go in and be prepared and present your best offer up front, as Kurt said. Unless there's not multiple offer scenario, you might have a little room, but not seeing a lot of that right now. What about the inspection response? Can you talk a little bit on that, Kurt?
Yeah, you know, I basically, when I'm helping my clients, I recommend that once the inspection is done, taking a look at the whole inspection report, and focusing, if you're going to ask the seller to fix something, focusing on a few items that are basically health and safety items.
Mm-hmm.
Really important things that if they're not changed, you probably don't want to buy it anyways. I've been on the listing side of a situation like that where we received an inspection response. One of them, I think, had 20 or 21 items on it, and my jaw almost hit the ground. My first comment when I called my seller was, please don't shoot the messenger. It's just my job to tell you about this. You know, my thought was, they're just going to get mad and not do anything. The funny thing was, at least funny on our side, they decided to look on this as like the country buffet. It's like, wow, we've got 20 items to choose from. Let's pick the top 2 or 3.
And that's awesome.
One of them on there was literally a burnout light bulb. Where I'm looking at that going,
gosh,
you've got to be kidding me. And they looked at it like, yeah, burnout light bulb, that'd be great. What, a couple bucks down
sure,
the store?
We'll pick
and
that one.
The electrical items on there, no, those are too expensive. And so they picked 3 or 4 things. And I think the buyer thought that they could, you know, basically let go of the light bulb for the higher, you know, the more important items. And their agent tried to say, hey, look, these are the ones that are most important. But again, the process is the seller can pick any ones they want. And so trying to keep to the most important items.
Yep.
And keeping it simple is the best way to go.
Makes total sense. Single family home, condo.
Yes, I think generally if somebody can afford a single family home, in general terms, they usually appreciate at a higher rate or faster rate than a condo. Though condos also can and certainly do go up. But there's also some less risks with condos, you have HOAs and you have risk of special assessments and such. And so I would tend to advised more towards the or favor the single family if they can afford to do that.
Yeah, and lenders have a higher interest rate for condo than single family home because it is a higher risk of default. Sellers listening, we've got just a second before I've got to wrap us up here. Maximize their returns. What's advice do you have there, Kurt?
Yeah, you know, I go with the old saying, you only have one chance to make a first impression or the good first impression. And so once you sit down with your agent and you're figuring out what to do, some general items are declutter the home. You're going to be moving anyways. And so the more you're going to be packing everything up. And so the more the items that you don't need to have in there every day that you can box those up and get into storage. And It just helps the house present better. If you can stage it, that's ideal, whether it's with your furniture or bringing in some furniture from a stager. And once you get the house ready to go and the exterior is done, I highly, highly recommend getting a professional photographer out there.
Yes.
Because the first impression these days is usually on the internet when yep. people are clicking through pictures. And if you don't grab their attention on the first go, you're probably going to lose them, and the likelihood of them coming back is really low.
Yep, they'll hit delete, and then you'll never show up in the search criteria again. So yeah. That would be pretty bad. Kurt, thank you so much. It was great having you in for the first time. Look forward to having you back. Great advice for my buyers and for my sellers. Just really appreciate your time.
Thank you, Tina.
And this is your host, Tina Mitchell, signing off for the day. I will be back same time, same place next Saturday right here on 1150 AM KKNW. Enjoy the rest of your weekend, everyone. Thanks.